We'll be talking about 18th century prose. Who will be talking about 18th century British prose? And as we can see that here we have only one student, so this recording may be used for further online sessions. And I welcome you, Heba ma'am. Thank you so much. And I hope this session is fruitful. May you please continue with the session, ma'am?
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Thank you. So, good afternoon to one and all. And I, Heba Farin, an academic consultant in English from Odisha State Open University, has provided us a platform for starting this online session. So I consider myself privileged for getting this opportunity for having this interaction with our learners. So today, we are going to start up a lesson on periodical essays. And English literature, periodical essays is an important gift of the 18th century to English literature. In today's class, we shall learn what is a periodical and how it's different from periodical essays during the period of the Augustan age. And also we will learn about the history of periodical essays. To start with, let us know what are the different objectives of this lesson, which is to study one of the major movement of the English literature in detail and summarize it for better understanding, to analyze the Augustine period from the aspects of periodical essays with critical appreciation and relations with the society, with a special reference to the essay writers. Now, what is an essay? An essay is any short composition in prose that undertakes to discuss a matter, expresses a point of view, that persuades us to accept a thesis on any subject, or simply entertain. The essay differs from a treatise in its having less affectations, to be a systematic and a complete exposition, and in being addressed to a general rather than a specialized audience. As a consequence, the essay discusses its subject in technical fashion and often with liberal use of such devices like anecdotes, striking allusions, and humor. To augment its appeal, periodical essays is one of the most important literary features of English literature. The Augustine age was a brilliant literary period with artists such as Virgil, Horace, Ovid under the Roman August Empire. In the 18th century, Joseph Edison and Sir Richard Steele's Tatler, Spectator, with their many successes, gave to the essay written in prose standard, modern vehicle with emphasis on social concerns and their ideals of moderation, decorum, and urbanity. So in today's class, we shall discuss the history of periodical essay in the Augustine age, that is the 18th century, and its social perspective through some essays and writers to begin with Augustine age. During the half of the 18th century, England was in many respects uncivilized roads and were dangerous and infected with robbers. So it was unsafe to go out after dark. The police and the watch were inefficient and hopeless. So men of letters were often attacked and beaten by the poets or the politicians when they had criticized or vilified. Like Alexander Pope was also threatened by Ambrose Phillips with a rod which was hung up for his chastisement outside Buttons. Then coffee house at a later period, when his satires had stirred up a nest of hornets. The poets was in a habit of carrying pistols and taking a dog for his companion when walking out a twin cam. The later half of the 18th century is an age of reaction, age of translation, an age. And the men of Pope's time had reacted against the armor, immortality of the Restoration era, and excesses of the metaphysical. So they made reason and good sense their guides and developed a rigid formalism, disrupted emotions and enthusiasm, so that the atmosphere of their life and writing became hard and dry. In the age of Dr. Johnson, we find that there is a reaction against the self-complacency, the artificiality, the formalism and intellectuality of the previous age. So there's a renaissance of feeling and awakening to the wonder and mystery of the world around. So after many conflicts of the mid-17th century in the English society and culture, it settled down into a period of stability until political revolution in France and industrial revolution at home helped to produce another era of more rapid change and more violent conflict of ideas. So during this age, it became possible to distinguish the view of life and letters, which was to be considered as Augustine. London became more and more a center of literary and intellectual life of the country due to the influence of writers who came to look at polite London society, the old idealism by which men had lived and over which they had fought and died, also became more civilized. Then economics and ethics were finally separated. The new economic field was political arithmetic, which proved to their own satisfaction that the individual desire to make money can produce plenty and poverty can only be the result of idleness. So society refused to take responsibility for those of its member who fell by the wayside in London. The coffee house replaced the court as the meeting place of men of culture. The education and the entertainment of the middle class became a legitimate objective of literature. The differences between the courtesy books of the Renaissance and essays of Edison and Steele in the early 18th century illustrate with quite startling clarity the differences between the old and aristocratic education and the new general variety. So the periodical essays that in particular that we are speaking of, to discuss further about the periodical essays, we need to know that periodical essay was a new literary form that emerged during the early part of the 18th century. Periodical essay is an important gift of our excellent and indispensable 18th century to English literature. If any literary form is the particular creation and the particular mirror of the Augustan age in England, it is the periodical essays. So typically it appeared in effort like Abel publication that came out regularly, usually two or three times a week, and were only one or two pages in length. So it's unlike other publication of the time that consisted of a medley of information and news, essays, periodicals were comprised of a single essay on a specific topic or theme, usually having to do with conduct or manners. So they were often narrated by a person or a group of person, commonly referred to as a club. Mostly, readers of the periodical essays were the educated middle-class individuals who held learning in high esteem, but were not scholars or intellectuals. women were growing part of this audience. And periodical editors often tried to appeal them in their publications. The periodical essays found a spectacular response in the 18th century on account of various reasons. Fundamentally, this new genre was in perfect harmony with the spirit of age. It sensitively combined the taste of different classes of readers, with the result that appealed to, although particularly to, resident of the middle class in the 18th century. So there was a phenomenal spurt in literacy, which expanded widely the circle of readers. They welcomed the periodical essays as it was light literature. The brevity of the periodical essays, its common sense approach, and a tendency to dilute morality and philosophy for popular consumption paid rich dividends to a great extent. The periodical assist assumed the office of the clergyman and taught the masses the lesson of elegance and refinement, though not of morality or of some singing, but singing kind. The periodical paper was particularly welcomed as it was not a dry, highbrow or hoity-toity affair like the professional sermon, in spite of being highly instructive in nature. In most cases, the periodical essayist did not speak from the clouds, but communicated with the reader with an almost buttonholing familiarity. The avoidance of politics, though not by all the periodical essayist, yet by good many of them, also contributed towards its popularity. Again, the periodical essayist made it a point to cater for the female taste and give due consideration to the female point of view. That one, for them, many female readers, to all these factors were responsible for the universal acceptance of the periodical essays in the 18th century England. The Tatler in the year 1709 to 1711 and the Spectator from 1711 to 1712 were the most successful, influential periodicals of the 18th century. But there are many periodicals that help shape this literary genre, and we shall discuss some of these periodicals to the following sections. So, first of all, we need to know the history behind the periodical essay. So, there is a history everywhere. While the periodical essay emerged during the 18th century and reached its peak in publication like Tatler and the Spectator, it can be traced back to the late 17th century. The most influential periodical essay for the Spectator is John Donne's Tianjin, Athenian Mercury, which played an important role in the development of the periodical essay. The Athenian Mercury began publication in 1691 with the purpose of resolving weekly all the most nice and curious questions proposed by the imaginative censors. They didn't publish in an essay instead of following a question and answer or advice column format. So it is one of the first periodicals to solicit questions from its audience, readers, and submitted questions anonymously. And their candid inquiries were answered by a collection of experts known as Athenian Society, or simply the Athenians. Danton hinted that the Athenian Society was made up of a group of learned individuals, but in reality, the society only consisted of three people who were not necessarily authorities. Their identities remained a secret, however, And this is one of the first instances of a periodical using a fictional social group or club to answer questions or narrate a story. Each issue of the Athenian Mercury would answer anywhere from 8 to 15 questions on topics ranging from love, marriage, and relationship to medicine, superstitions, and paranormal. So Danton received so many questions from female readers that he decided to devote first Tuesday of every month to questions from women. So this periodical, originally known as a weekly review of France, the France purged from the errors and partially of the news. So writers and petty statesmen of all sides, the review began publication in the year 1704 as an 8-page weekly. And the title, length, and frequency of the periodical changed in subsequent issues until it eventually became a tri-weekly periodical entitled The Review. Most issues of the review consisted of a single essay, usually covering a political topic, which was followed by question and answer section called the Mercurial Scandal or Advice from the Scandal Group. Eventually, it replaced the translated of French with a weekly history of nonsense, impertinence, a vice and debauchery in this section, a fictional group known as Scandal Club, answered the readers' questions on a variety of subjects, including drinking, gambling, love, and treatment of women. The advice column component of the review was so popular among readers that they began publishing a 28-page monthly supplement devoted entirely to readers' questions. On May 1705, Defoe dropped the advice from the scandal group from the review and began publishing the questions and answers separately in publication entitled The Little Review. With their advice column elements, there were obvious imitators of the 18 Mercurial column. However, the questions and answer in periodicals were longer and mostly written as letters. And this type of prose writing would eventually evolve into a single essay format of the Tatler and the Spectator. Like other periodicals of the time, the advice from the Scandal Group and the Little Review addressed questions of behavior and conduct, but the Ford's tone was more satirical, and he would often mock the stuffiness of the Athenian Mercury in his essays. The Ford's periodicals were also less manly, and he often plays designed for products like remedies for venereal syndrome within their pages. So the Tatler, that was in 1709 and 1711. So let us now move to the segment where we will be discussing about the Tatler and the Spectator, Joseph Edison, in the years 1672 to 1719, and Richard Steele from 1672 to 1729. So they were the great educators of the English middle class at the beginning of 18th century. So we are at the same time eager to bridge the gap between town and city, represented at the Restoration by courtly fashion of sneering at the uncouthness and simplicity of visiting squires, and also to unite past and present to re-establish the continuity of English history. So they effectively pooled their talents to achieve extraordinary success in the endeavor to enliven morality with wit and to temper wit with morality. So their aim was completely educational. The single essay made its first appearance in the Tatla, which began its publication in the year 1709, created by Richard Steele. The purpose of the Tatla was to offer something whereby such were members of the public may be instructed, and after the reading, what to think and to have something of which may be of entertainment to the fair sex. Steele was a creator, but other significant writers of the time include Joseph Edison and Jonathan Swift were also the contributor. The Tatler was a single sheet of papers that came out three times a week, and in the beginning consisted of short paragraphs on topics related to domestic, foreign, financial events, literature, theater, and gossip. Like the journalism developed in the last decade of the 17th century, but Steele was a little different. Each topic fell under the heading of a specific place, such as coffee house, where the discussion was most likely to take place. Isaac Bickerstaff, the 60-something fictional editor, narrated the Tatler and his thoughts on the miscellaneous subjects were included under the heading "From My Own Apartment" in an attempt to appeal to his female audience. Still introduced the Jenny stuff, Isaac Bickerstaff, half-sister, and she narrated some of the essays later in the periodicals. Last issue of the Tatler appeared in March 1711. So Steele launched a new periodical, The Spectator, with Joseph Edison, contributing 42 of the total 71 papers. The Spectator was published daily and consisted of a single essay on a topic, usually having to do with conduct or public behavior, and contained no political news. The Spectator was narrated by the fictional persona, Mr. Spectator, with some help from six members of the Spectator Club. While the Tatler introduced the form of the periodical essay, the Spectator perfected it and firmly established it as a literary genre. Edison, in the first issue of the Spectator, introduced himself as, "Thus I live in the world rather as a spectator of mankind than as one of the species." He also gave a background like, "I was born to a small hereditary estate, which according to the tradition of the village where it lies, were bounded by the same hedges and ditches in William the Conqueror time, that is, it's as the present, and has been delivered down from father to son, whole and entire, without the loss or acquisition of a single field or meadow during the space of 600 years. So it was Edison who developed many of these devices to their ultimate perfection, just as he developed the character of Cavalli from Steele's first sketch in the 70s. Spectator. So Edison, though his readers he despised, though they do not obey the rules of literary critics. The rules themselves are based on nature, and so human nature and the permanent qualities of men and things. And so even a root poet who follows nature will find himself doing in, however humble, a way what the great classical poets did. It consisted in resemblance and congruity of ideas, and which drew on accidental physical resemblance and congruity with letters, words, and shapes of sentences. The Spectator remained influential even after it ceased its publication in the year 1712. Other 18th century periodicals included Samuel Johnson, The Rambler, which copied the periodical essays format. Issues of Tatler and Spectator were published in a book form and continued to sell for the rest of the century. The popularity of the periodical essay eventually started to decline. However, and essays began appearing more often in periodicals that included other titles by the middle 18th century periodicals, comprising of a single essay, eventually disappeared altogether from the market. So Dr. Johnson, Goldsmith, so we will be now moving to the next segment of this lesson, that we will be discussing about Dr. Johnson and other periodicals writers in the second half of the 18th century. So the periodical essays showed a tendency to cease as an independent publication to get incorporated into the newspaper as just another feature. The series of about 100 papers of Dr. Johnson called The Idler, for example, was contributed to the newspaper The Universal Chronicle, April 15, 1758 and April 5, 1760. So these papers are lighter and shorter than those published in the periodical paper, The Rambler. Rambler appeared twice a week between March 20, 1752 and March 14, 1750. And ran to 208 numbers. So Dr. Johnson as a periodical essayist was much more serious in the purpose than Steele and Edison, and had been his lack of humor and unrelieved gravity coupled with his ponderous English, so make his Rambler paper quite heavy reading. The lack of popularity of the Rambler can easily be ascribed to this very fact. Among the papers that followed the Rambler may be mentioned Edward Moore's Worlds and the novelist Henry Mackenzie, Mirror and Lounger. A significant development was the creation of magazine, or what we call digest today. It was an anthology of interesting material which had already appeared in recent newspapers. The first magazine was Edward Cave Monthly, the gentleman's magazine, founded in the year 1731. The work of magazine caught on many magazines, including the magazines in the year 1752. 1751 appeared and disappeared. Along with magazines may be mentioned The Critical Review, devoted to the criticism of books. The first such periodical was Ralph Griffith's Monthly Review. We are sure that we all have heard of Oliver Goldsmith. In the end, we can consider the work of Oliver Goldsmith, who contributed to near about 10 periodicals, including the Monthly Review. His own, be it in 1759, ran to only 8 weekly numbers, The Citizen of the World in 1762. So Goldsmith's best work is a collection of essays which originally appeared in the public ledger as Chinese letters. So Goldsmith's essays are rich in human details, a quivering sentimentalism and candidness of spirit. His prose style is likewise quite attractive, and he avoids bitterness, coarseness, pedantry, and stiff wit. His style, in the words of George Urban, lacks the boldness of aristocratic manner, and it escapes the tendency of his generation to follow Johnson into excessive heaviness of diction and balanced formality of sentence structure. It is precisely for this lack of formality and for his graceful and sensitive ease, fluency, and vividness that we value his style. The style of periodical essays shall be discussed now, that it's one of the most of the periodical essays used a simple and conversational style so as to be able to understand and appreciated by their semi-educated audience and unscholarly common readers. So Jane H. Jack was a critic and observer. So these periodical writers prided themselves on being nearer in our style to that of common talk than any other writers. And they can be loud that ubiquity of these essays had a good effect on the prose style of the century as a whole. The periodical essayist could indulge in individual conceits, witticism, or even hard words only at his peril. Women who made up a large proportion of readers could appreciate such things, even less their male counterpart. The style to be simple and clear, and how disastrous an effect the use of a heavy style could have on the popularity of a periodical is obvious from the case of Dr. Johnson's Rambler, which never circulated above 500 copies. So the Spectator, on the other hand, ran to no fewer than 5,000 copies. So this was the background of the periodical essays. I hope you would have liked it and have understood some of the basics of the periodical essays. So now we are heading towards the essay named Friendship. As the very title of the essay suggests, that friendship, a friend in need is a friend in need. So friend is one who shows their love in when a friend is in trouble, not in happiness, and a real friend who walks in when the rest of the world walks out. So the quality that a friend must have is to be understand and to be understood. So there are numerous examples that has been provided by Joseph Edison in this essay. So when we'll be reading his essay that focuses on friendship, so first of all, we need to know that Joseph Edison, who belonged to 18th century, he was an English poet, author, playwright. He was a politician and a classic scholar. And along with his friend Richard Steele, both contributed as Edison and Steele, they were famous by the literary lovers. So they wrote and published periodicals in the Augustan Age and essays, The Spectator and The Tatler as a magazine. So people used to subscribe, and it was quite popular in the coffee house in London. And it reached all the reading public and became perfectly a reading material. So topical issues that related were the manners and morality that never, that without sounding pedantic and without sounding pedantic. So one of the finest periodical essay that Edison wrote when compared to the counterpart. So his was quite, when compared with Steele, it was quite compatible and quite good by the comparison. So Edison, who was born in 1672 at Milston, Wiltshire, and he was educated at Lambertown University and had a Charterhouse School, where he met Steele, and he used to serve as the under secretary to new Lord Lieutenant of Ireland, and even he was secretary to South Department to Lord Wharton. So the conversational prose style, his wild wit and humor influenced the development of informal essays. So Edison wrote legendary Cato tragedy. Legendary Cato, it was a tragedy that was believed to be a literary inspiration behind American Revolution. So he started with casually, he used to wrote the essays, and he was known for his magnanimity and cool personality. And he helped to establish the English literary congregation like Kit Kat Club. And he was a powerful poli and with the powerful political connections. And his wo and he was the only critic who knows how to ridicule without inflicting a wound. and he even tried to control society, not like his contemporaries like Pope, Drayton, and Defoe, who were personal in the satire. Edison's satire satirizes anything that is, he never used to satirize anything that was serious or that used to, never used to find the defect of the mankind. His essay, now we will be analyzing his essay named Friendship, in which we will be finding all the varieties of friendship and told by him. So he said, sarcastically can be said that a friend is one that a person is never a friend who one can be found only at the dinner table, and so it cannot be trusted or cannot be a one who would be helpful in the time of worries. So a faithful one would be a medicine, he would be a defender, and he would be a treasure. So, and a person who is God-fearing and who has faith in Lord, he would be a person to find a true and a faithful friend. And in particularly, in when we are in a friend group or a friend circle, the communication is quite free and open, and there is, and we move from formality to freeness. And whether we will be gathering at or whenever there's a gathering, there's whether the club or the enlightened spirit, the way the friends talk is quite different, and that's the way that he used to say. So Edison has successfully observed what Bacon and Tully said about friendship, and how it improves happiness and abates misery, how it doubles the joy and divides all our grief. So Greek philosopher Confucius' apocryphal treatise also says that the art of making friendships is like obliging, affable behavior, and recommended. Many well-known, there may be many well-wishers, but to have few friends. But we do have few friends. So he is also quite confident that we can get many friends, and through our kind words and fair way of speaking and how we speak the sweet language. So we need to maintain peace with everyone, and at least one counselors in thousands is the one that is needed. And he even advises us to keep away from enemies and rather give importance to our friend. He glorifies friends to be a medicine of life, a healer of pain and anguish. And he even says that it helps him to be courageous in this world. And he even says that if you choose a right person as a friend, one who's faithful friend of yours, then you can win over every moment that heeds in your life. And according to him, every faithful friend is unique and it cannot be compared. Like old friend is compared to an old wine, it's quite tastier. And a new wine is to a new wine, and it too has its freshness. So great, there is a greatness and uniqueness in both nature. And he do condemns to those who fail to understand faithful friend and violates the true friendship. Because violating is like swaying a rod, swaying a sword at one's loved one. And he do convinces that even though if our relationship has turned bitter, there is a chances of reconciliation too. And he even cautions us against those who have insulted their friends in anger, or even one those who have disclosed secrets or have inflicted a treacherous wound. So in that case, it would be quite they would be left without a friend. So every friend will depart from them. And moreover, getting the same person again is quite too difficult a task, like a deer that has escaped from a trap. So when Horace says on constancy and faithfulness as a principal quality of good friendship, Cicero says on the pleasantness of temper, virtue, discretion, equality in age, and fortune to it. While Edison was of a different view, he rather says that equability, evenness of behavior, very lucky, unlucky for a man to be entangled in friendship with one by which we live, and the circumstances that make the people change. So of the humor, he says that one may be, at the sometime they may be amicable, and the other they might be odious. So that's quite change of the personality of the person in the different situations. So moreover, so he says that one must be taking care of oneself and keep oneself in a good stride, and the nature of one should be an agreeable to oneself and to the others as well. So regarding the style of the essays and how it was written, it was quite polished and cultivated. And the typical example of, and this shows his typical example of his style, is quite preciseness of his expression. There's a elegant manner, and his observation is quite delightful, and plasticity of language. And language is not very ornamental or ornate. Its spontaneity and ease in the essays makes the reader fix the ideas in mind without ambiguity. So periodical essays affected structural transformation in the 18th century through persistent engagement with matters concerning emergent middle class. And even the scholar like Samuel Johnson says that whoever wishes to attain English style, one must be make oneself familiar with the, but not coarse, elegant, but not ostentatiously. One must give his days and night to the volumes of Edison. So it was a quite a short essay of Edison, and there was a few quotation from the essays too. So that should be kept in purview while reading and writing the essay. So this was all I was having for today's session. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Heba ma'am. This was indeed a very comprehensive and well explained class, and I hope a lot of students who will listen to this session are going to be benefited. And thank you so much, and I think we are good to call it a day. And thank you all of you.
Thank you to one and all.